Would anybody care to venture a guess as to where we are today? First guess. Should have had a guess at that.
You know, when you get a certain age.
I want to share with you guys, I was going to put some pictures up and they're still sitting on my phone. But I wanted to share you guys what an awesome group of men we have at this church. You know, there's never been a need that I've ever been aware of that hasn't been met. And a few months back, Matthew came up with the idea of having a wood pantry to help people out with firewood for the winter. And so, I don't know, a month or a month and a half ago, we went up and cut a bunch of wood. And yesterday we showed up at Matthew's house to walk and split it. Wow, was there a lot of wood. I'm not kidding. It was probably 10 or 12 feet high. And I don't know, how long was it, Matthew? Maybe 40 feet, 50 feet by 20 maybe? I don't know, I got pictures and you can see the little people that is us standing in front of it. But we had quite a few people showing up. We had three guys on chainsaws blocking. We had three different crews on log splitters splitting. And I think we made a dent. But it was awesome. I mean, the word goes out, there's a project that needs done, and people always step up to do it. So I want to say thank you, especially to the men yesterday that came out and worked and got the wood split up, got several loads. I don't know, I think we took four or five loads and delivered four or five loads. We have some more that's going to be delivered next weekend. So thank you, gentlemen, very much for all your hard work. It is very much appreciated. And that you can clap. So we are in Colossians. We're back to our regularly scheduled program after our short diversion last week. My hope was to cover seven verses today. I know, pull yourselves back up. It's not going to happen. I don't think it's going to happen. I don't think I can do justly to God's word by trying to rush through it. And I don't think we should. And if that means we only do a couple verses a week, we got time. You know, we got as much time as we need till he comes back. Yeah. And if he comes back and we're still in Colossians, so much the better. So, we are in Colossians chapter 2. We're all the way up at verse 8. And now before I read this, I want to kind of remind you of a couple things. When we did the introduction to the book of Colossians, one of the things that Paul was writing this letter for was because of the Gnostics or the pre-Gnostic movement. Does anybody remember what attributes the pre-Gnostic movement had? What was it that he was kind of arguing against? Anybody?
Secret knowledge?
Secret knowledge, yeah. The Gnostics basically had this idea that in order to reach God, you had to have inside information that usually only they were privy to. And you could only gain this knowledge by going through their rituals and through their things and elevating up, and when you got to a certain level, you got a little bit of information, and then you got to another level, and you got a little bit more information, and so on and so forth. And they were also known as the mystery cults. You see quite a bit of that today. You see that in the New Age movement today. We see it in a lot of different things today. And as we talk through today's message, I want you to be aware that this is happening even at this point in the founding of the Christian church. Okay, so what we see today is absolutely nothing new. God's not taken off guard. God knows what's going on. God deals with it. He deals with it appropriately. Okay, so we're going to start in verse 8. We're going to read. See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ. For in him the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily. And you have been filled in him, who is the head of all rule and authority. I'm going to continue reading, but I think that's about as far as we're going to get today. But in the hopes, okay, in him you were also circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the powerful working of God who raised him from the dead. And you who were dead in your trespasses and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses, by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. Now, I'm telling you, next week, God willing, I am really excited about what we're getting to cover next week, because this is all about the awesome work that God did through the cross. What God put on the line on our behalf. So, mark it in your calendars next Sunday. You want to be here to hear this. Not to hear this, to hear this. Okay? But today, we're going to talk about the first few verses here. And the first thing that jumped out at me when I read this says, see to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit. Now, does anybody know what philosophy is? I mean, we kind of have this idea that floats around in our head. And I was trying to put it down so I could explain it to you. And I thought, I can't even explain it, really. So I went to the dictionary. And here's what the dictionary has to say about philosophy. It's a noun. And it is the rational investigation of the truths and principles of being, knowledge, or conduct. Another definition is a system of principles for guidance in practical affairs. Okay. Now, I always like to know what the author meant when he used that word. So I went back and I looked up the Greek. And you know what the Greek word for philosophy is?
Philosophy.
Yeah. Except that they do a AU. And it's philosophy. Philosophy. And so what is the definition of what he's talking about here? Well, according to, and I just forgot the name of the dictionary. Of course, I didn't write it down.
Webster.
No, not Webster. It's the Bible dictionary, not Unger's.
Strong's?
Not Strong's. Thayer's. Thank you.
Welcome.
Okay. Thayer's, yes. Yes. I'll talk to you about it later. And what the word literally means is a love of wisdom. Okay? It's used either of zeal for or skill in any art or science, any branch of knowledge, used once in the New Testament of the theology, or rather theosophy, of certain Jewish Christian ascetics, which busied themselves with refined and speculative inquiries into the nature and classes of angels, into the ritual of the Mosaic Law and the regulations of Jewish tradition respecting practical life. Okay, you get all that?
No.
Basically, what it is it's used one time, and it's right here. And it's specifically addressing the Gnostic movement, the mystery movement. Okay? The difference between theology, the study of God, and... I'm going to try and say this right, because I'm going to mess it up if I don't. Theosophy is that in theology, you are studying the person and the nature of God. In theosophy, you're trying to figure him out and getting all the answers. Okay? Instead of Scott and I having a relationship whereby we get to know one of each other, I read everything that I can possibly find about Scott. And I can tell you, yeah, Scott likes baseball. He's really good at softball. He sells phones. He thinks horses are absolutely great for the dog food market and glue industry. I can tell you all those things by reading about him, but I don't know Scott. okay? I just know about him. Okay? So we have this entire movement that is being dealt with right here, who thinks that they can scientificize God. We're going to do an empirical study and figure out God. And we're going to classify him and we're going to quantify him and put him in a neat little box for everybody to understand. Okay? Now, it's interesting that Paul uses that word philosophy, because philosophy is an original Greek identification. The Greeks were the ones that made it what it is. We're going to take things and we're going to take them apart, figure out how they work, put them back together again, and then explain them to everybody. And not just mechanical things, but everything. Okay? They did some incredible things. I mean, the mathematics that they came up with, the study and the understanding of astronomy. I mean, they did some incredible things. But they missed the point. Because, see, he associates philosophy with what's the next word that follows that? Philosophy and what? No? Empty deceptions. See, what Paul is saying is that all of the incredible learning that you guys can get, that the world has to offer, he's associating it with deceit that carries no value, has nothing of value to it. It's garbage. So he says, we've got this philosophy, but it leads to nothing. Paul addresses that elsewhere in 1 Corinthians. I'm going to flip over there. You don't need to turn there real quick. I'll just read it for you, because we're going to bounce around a bit today. So I'm going to flip over 1 Corinthians 13. Oops, that's Romans. Everybody knows what 1 Corinthians 13 is, right? Love. The love chapter. And I'm not talking love like the 60s kind of love. Okay? Paul starts off, he says, and if I speak in the tongue of men and of angels but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains but have not love, I am nothing. See, we have to have an understanding. We in America have grown up into a mentality that was laid down by the Greeks. Okay? It's established by the Greeks. All Western thought draws its roots from Greek thinking. And it's peculiar. Because in the East, they look at us and go, what are you even talking about? I don't mean like New York, although they do that with us. I'm talking about like the Middle East and the Far East. They don't get us because we want everything to be empirical. We want it to be able to be put in its proper place. We want to know the whys. Rather than accepting that something is, we want to know why it is. And then we want to know how we can manipulate it. Okay? So, we have this all knowledge and all wisdom and all faith, but if we don't have love, we've got nothing. So Paul, if you read through the writings of Paul, you'll see that he hits on this over and over and over and over again. Why? Because see, our puny brains, our finite small brains can't rationalize, cannot comprehend, cannot ever understand an infinite God. To try and take infinity and squish it down into this little head space, and you can put your hand over your own head because we all got little head space, doesn't work. It doesn't work. Why? God didn't design it to work that way. Okay? God is not impressed with your knowledge. God is not impressed with your wisdom. In Hebrews, God doesn't tell us, without you being a super intellect, it's impossible to make me happy. Once you reach a 12th grade United States of America education, then I'm happy with you. Once you've gone through the right doctrinal instruction and you've gone to the right Bible college, then I will be pleased with you. He doesn't do that. Why? Because he designed us to not be there. He designed us with a component that he wants, that he longs. What is that? Faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Impossible. Okay? So, I would posit to you right now, and just as opening statement, Paul is associating the frailty of human thinking with nothing. It's of no value when it stands in contrast. Okay? Now, don't get me wrong. There is value. God did make us to be thinking creatures. Okay? I think God invented the word why. Why did God invent the word why? So we would seek Him out. So we would pursue Him. So we would pursue knowledge of Him. I don't know at what point science diverged from seeking to understand God through the natural order of things to eliminating God and disproving God so that we can do things our own. But you don't ever hear of faith and science. As a matter of fact, you hear that those two are diametrically opposed. Why? Why? Why is it that science cannot be used to prove our faith? Why does it always seem to point against faith? Why does it work in opposition? Why? Because it's the world system. Let's go back to Colossians 2 verse 8. See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit according to human traditions, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ. Look, without Christ, you are in opposition to Christ. Okay? Jesus said, if they're not for us, they are opposed to us. Right? Now, there's another passage that says, if they're not opposed to us, they're for us. Well, who was he talking about then? Remember that? Does anybody remember that passage? Yes. Hey, Jesus, they're doing miracles in your names, and they're saying things about you. Should we stop them? No, see, because they were actually preaching Jesus. No. If they're not in opposition to us, then they are for us. They're preaching Jesus. But elsewhere he says, no, look, if you're not going to be standing for me, you're going to be in opposition to me. And when you decide that you don't need Jesus, when you choose otherwise, all you have left is your puny brain. Honestly, how many of us without the instructions can figure out the 3-in-1 remote control? Huh? Okay, so you think you're going to figure out the mysteries of this universe without Christ on your own. Good luck with that. So now, I'm going to back up a little bit because there's a phrase here that I want to address here. See to it that no one takes you captive. Okay? No one takes hold of you. Do you see that happening today? Do you see that happening today? Let me give you a simple example here. Why is it that creation science is not in our schools? Why is it? I'm not talking about theology. I'm talking about creation science. The science that something out there created everything. Why is that not out there? Because science is the study of everything to see how it works. Why is it that all of a sudden we've isolated ourselves to one potential, quite honestly ludicrous, scientific idea of evolution? You really want to get under an evolutionist skin? Ask them about point X. Ask them about point X. It had to start somewhere. Stephen Hawking, one of the greatest physicists, one of the greatest scientific minds of our age, has said, I can bring you all the way back with clear explanation to point X. When we get to point X, I have nothing to offer. Where did it come from? Well, there were two carbon molecules wandering through the infinity of space. Well, first, where did the carbon molecules come from? Second, where did space come from? And they crashed into each other. You know how big those things are? And in the infinity of space, they found each other and crashed into each other? So there had to be more than two. Oh yeah, well, the space was much smaller then. But really, back to my original point. Why is it that if we are honest, if we are honest in our intellectual integrity, we refuse to allow any opinion other than the one that we've determined we want? Why is that?
Because that would mean we're not the boss.
That's exactly right. It means there might be an accountability to something else. See, because how this ends up here. Now, I'm going to read another section here. According to human tradition. See, evolution is in school now because it's traditional now. It's traditional. It's a lot harder to get something out once it's in than to get it in the first place. Except for that chunk of wood that went into my arm yesterday. That was really easy to get in, kind of difficult to get out. I'm okay, though. According to human tradition, according to the, my translation, I don't like the way that the English Standard translated this. My translation says, according to the elemental spirits of the world. I think the New American Standard actually hits it closer. I think it says the elemental principles. That the idea is what makes a thing work. Okay, the governing principles by which something operates. Okay, you can put gas in a car, but it's not going to run without a motor. That's an elementary principle. Okay, these things are human tradition according to the elemental principles or spirits of the world. Okay, so we look at, okay, I'm going to give an example I learned in science class. Did you know that they used to believe that flies were spawned from rotten meat? They would leave meat out, and it would get rotten, and then all of a sudden, poof, 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 there'd be flies. Kind of like magic. And that was the elementary principles of the world is, there's a piece of meat, it's rotten, and there are flies coming out of the meat. Therefore, flies must be spawned from rotten meat. Now, according to science, you can prove that over and over and over again. Just leave the meat out and let it rot, and flies will come out. But somebody got smart and put a lid over the meat. No flies. Okay? That's an elementary principle. So, the problem that we're seeing here, the contrast that we see here, that Paul is telling us is, look, the world without Christ tries their best to figure things out, and they're always going to get it wrong, because apart from Christ, there is no truth. There is no truth. It's empty deceit. Okay? What is a deceit?
A lie.
A lie. Okay? So if we have a philosophy that is an empty deceit, our philosophy is a
lie.
If we're basing it on our human traditions, did you know there probably wasn't a Christmas tree when Jesus was born? There probably wasn't even the whole little plastic manger thing under there. Did you know that? Stockings. I haven't figured out where stockings were in there. Where did they hang them? Well, that's a human tradition, right?
Yeah.
Right? Now, I'm not saying any of those things are necessarily bad, because Paul tells us, I don't care what you're celebrating, celebrate it unto God. It was all his in the first place. But what I'm saying is, we do a lot of things that are based on human tradition. You know, there's the story of the young lady, she'd gotten married, and she went to the store, and she was going to make a roast for her husband. And she came home, and she cut the roast in half, and put it in two pots, and stuck it in the oven and cooked it. And he came home, and he opened it, and looked at it. Sweetheart, love of my life, why are there two pot roasts and two different pans in the oven? Well, because that's how you cook a pot roast. Well, that might be how you cook a pot roast. But why didn't you just use the big pan and cook them in the big pan? Well, I don't know. That's just the way we've always done it. So she calls her mom. Mom, why do you cut the pot roast and put it in two pans to cook it? Oh, because when your father and I were first married, I didn't have a pan big enough. So I would cut it and put it in two and cook them both together. Now, there's a very logical reason for why she did what she did. But the human tradition passed down, all of a sudden it makes sense, doesn't it? I mean, sweetheart, if you want to cook it in two pots, I don't care. I don't really care. I just want it cooked on my plate. Cook it however you want, all right? But do you see the problem here? The problem here is, without Christ, we try to figure out things on our own, with careful observation, with repeated endeavor, time and time again, we will always come to the wrong conclusion because our brains are too small. Okay? What's electricity? Can somebody explain to me what electricity is? Anybody? Do we have any scientists in here?
It's expensive.
It's electrons. Well, that's what it's made up of, but what is it? You know, it wouldn't matter if you were a scientist, because scientists can't explain what electricity is. We know where to find it, how to reproduce it, how to make it work for us, but we still can't explain really what it is. It simply is. And so we just go on. So Paul is addressing a very critical issue here. Okay? Because he's telling us, first, your philosophy without Christ, your philosophy. Now, is philosophy in and of itself bad? No. No. I mean, there have been some incredible philosophers with deep thoughts that I don't even get. I look at that and I thought, wow, he wrote 687 pages on something that I didn't understand at all. You need to work on your communication and less on your philosophy. So philosophy in and of itself is not bad. But it's with the associated empty deceit that it's a problem. So then it comes up and it says, first being taken captive, you got to be careful. Okay? Because you can be a slave without realizing you're a slave. You understand that? You can be a slave without realizing you're a slave. We have grown up in a specific culture, with a specific identity, with a specific lifestyle, and we assume that that's the way that it should be. Quite honestly, I like the Spanish idea of taking a nap at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. I think they got it right. I think we messed it up. I also like the French idea of at least an hour and a half lunch. Where in the world did we come up with a half hour lunch? Obviously it was by people that ate fast. But we come up with these ideas because it was what we were taught. Okay? It's what we were told, whether verbally or just by instruction in the life, in living life. Okay? And then we assume that that's right. That's the way it must be. We assume that if you're going to be a success in this life, you have to follow certain steps. And read some stories about people that were successful in life. They didn't follow any of the right steps. They went on gut instinct. And they took their last $7 and invested it in something that people went, you are absolutely out of your ever-loving mind. $1 billion later, they laugh. Okay? We have to be careful. Because if the measure by which we observe anything is apart from Christ, we're in trouble. Okay? Remember, what are the three omnis? He is omnipresent. He is everywhere at all time. He is omnipowerful, omnipotent. He can do anything that he wants, whatsoever he will. And he is omniscient. He knows everything all the time. He knows everything there is to know right now. And now. And now. And he still does. Still going, still going, still going. He always knows everything. Nothing is a surprise to him. Okay? So if he knows everything, do you think he knows how it works? Thaddeus loves Legos. Now, we got to come up with a new name for it because it's not Legos like I had when I was a kid. I had blocks. And there were twos, fours, sixes, and eights, and then occasionally a 12. And they were, you know, red and white and green and yellow. And you built whatever so you would with them. He's got models that are made out of Legos. I mean, we just replaced the plastic parts and the glue with interconnecting blocks. And he brings out this model and he's like, yeah, look at this, what this opens and this does this and this. And I'm like, wow, cool. I have no idea how he built it. No clue. I don't know why it's doing what it does. I don't know. Oh, there's a hinge there. Snap. This door will stay shut. Please use the south entrance. Okay? Who knows how it should work and why it works best that way? The one that built it. Okay? The one that made it. That's why Paul is contrasting here. This is a contrasting statement. He says, see to it that no one takes you captive. Open your eyes, see where you're captive. By philosophy and empty deceit, trying to figure it out on your own, according to human tradition, that's always the way it's been. The sun has always come up in the east and gone down in the west. Rises over the Atlantic, sets over the Pacific, right? Right? Wrong. You live on the Isthmus of Panama, and it comes up over the Pacific and drops down over the Atlantic. Do you know that's the only place in the world that you can see that? Human tradition. Okay? According to the elemental spirits or the elemental principles of the world and not according to Christ. Now, why? See, it doesn't give us a question without giving us an answer. Why? Why does it all depend on Christ? For in Him, the fullness of deity, the fullness of God, dwells bodily. Now think about that for a minute. Everything that makes God who He is, what He is, all of that was in Christ. In bodily form. Think about that. I mean, if you don't have a good picture of who God is, go read Genesis, the first couple chapters of Genesis. Go read the last few chapters of Job. See who God is. Get a little bit of a picture. Okay? All of that was in Jesus when He walked this earth. Now, what that should show you is the incredible restraint that He had. God didn't trust me with that because He knew I would have smoked you all. Would have started with the religious elite, those that thought they knew everything, and probably would have just continued from there. Thank God He didn't trust me. And I'm thanking God He didn't trust you. For in Him, the whole fullness, that means the totality, I just lost my place, of deity dwells bodily. And you have been filled in Him who is the head of all rule and authority. Okay, you have been filled in Him. Are you lacking anything? If you've been filled, you have no space for anything else, right? So are you lacking anything? No, you're not lacking anything. You've got everything you need. You're filled in Him. Now, there is a little bit of a problem here. These flies are really driving me nuts.
Must have brought meat around.
Not a bother. How big's your cup? How big is your cup? You see, if I take my cup that is filled with rancid pollution, my life, my choices, my selfishness, and I pour Jesus into it, the only way that he can fill me up is by displacing all of that which is me. That which is Glenn has to go. Paul says that I must decrease that he might increase. I've got to become less that he can become more. How much room is in your cup? See, there can't be any of you. Because in order to understand salvation, salvation always comes through the cross. And we're going to hit on this next week. We're going to go into great detail next week. In order, not just Jesus on the cross, that's the start of it. But you've got to come to the cross. Do you know that when a pilot lands on an aircraft carrier, he's completely subject to the meatball? You know what the meatball is? Down at the end of where he's going to land, there's a red, I don't know what they use now, it used to be a reflector and a light, and it would point which way he needed to turn to bring him centered in. You have to land specifically on an aircraft carrier, because if you don't, what happens? Well, if it don't, you don't land on an aircraft carrier. You miss the mark. You miss the target. And see, if you are approaching Christ any other way but following the meatball, you're going to make a train wreck of your life. You're going to make a train wreck of your faith. You're going to make a train wreck being a representative of him. You got to follow the meatball all the way in. I mean, there are those that see the meatball and ignore it entirely and end up in the brink. There are those that follow it right to the point of the ship and then think they got it. And bad things happen. In order for salvation to be true, you got to follow it all the way to the end. All the way to completion. You cannot stop short. Okay? Now, not to say this is easy. Not to say this is easy by any means. But what did we just talk about? He has given us everything we need. Everything. Okay? So, you know, sometimes we take a shovel and we spoon a little bit of ourselves out and he fills it right up. Sometimes we take tweezers and tweeze a little bit of ourselves out and he fills it up. Sometimes God comes in with a bulldozer and just wipes out whole blocks of us and fills it up. The whole understanding is we need more of him, less of us. He needs to be filled up in us. Okay. So moving on, because we're talking about why, according to Jesus is the only truth, says he's filled us up. And how does it describe Jesus? Who is the head of all rule and all authority. Who rules in America today?
Nobody.
Nobody. Which political party rules in America today? Huh? Right now, it's chaos. Because we got an ideological thought over here and an ideological thought over here. Never the two shall meet. Okay? But who's the president? Obama, yeah. Okay, is he ruling? Don't give me your political answers. No politics. Now, whether you agree with how he rules is irrelevant. But he is the president. And Scripture says we honor him because he is the president. Okay? What about the vice president? What about Secretary of State? What about Speaker of the House? What about Senate Majority Leader? Okay, see, the problem is, we all get caught up in our short-sighted vision. And we go, oh, okay, so The Democrats are in power now, and within a few years, or however long, because it always turns, it'll turn over to the Republicans. And then after a while, it'll turn back to the Democrats. Why does that happen?
People get bored.
That's it. But let me ask you this. Who's really in charge? God. God. Remember Daniel? Let's look at Daniel for a minute. Flip over to Daniel. Chapter 4. We actually talked about this a while back, and I'm not going to spend a great deal of time on it today. I'm going to give you the rundown. Okay? Nebuchadnezzar, King Nebi. He allows his close and intimate friends to call him that. He's the ruler of Babylon, okay? One of the greatest nations, the greatest nation of that time, okay? And his word is law. He can do whatsoever he will. And he has a dream. Now, keep in mind at this time, the Jews are in exile in Babylon. And he has a counselor by the name of Daniel. Well, Nebuchadnezzar has a dream, and it discomfits him. And he says, hey, I need somebody to tell me what this dream means. I have dreams all the time that discomfit me. I mostly chalk it up to eating too late at night. But this one obviously was something more than that. So he calls, Daniel comes and talks to him. Now, you've got to picture this, because Daniel is coming to the authority of a man that can snuff his life like that. Okay? He can take his life. And Nebuchadnezzar tells him this dream. Now I'm going to share with you a little bit about the dream. Okay, so he says, here's the vision. Oops, let me back up. He sees a tree. He says, and behold, a tree in the midst of the earth, and its height was great. The tree grew and became strong, and its top reached to the heavens, and it was visible to the ends of the whole earth. Its leaves were beautiful, and its fruit was abundant, and in it was food for all. The beasts of the field found shade under it, and the birds of the heavens lived in its branches, and all flesh was fed from it. I also saw in the visions in my head as I lay in bed, and behold, a watcher, a holy one, came down from heaven. He proclaimed aloud and said, thus, chop down the tree and lop off its branches, strip all its leaves, scatter its fruit. Let the beasts flee from under it and the birds from its branches, but leave the stump of its roots on the earth, bound with band of iron and bronze, amid the tender grass of the field. Let it be wet with the dew of heaven. Let his portion be with the beasts of the grass of the earth. Let his mind be changed from a man's, and let a beast's mind be given to him, and let 7 periods of time pass over him. The sentence is by the decree of the watchers, and the decision by the word of the holy ones, to the end of the living may. And that the end, let me try again, to the end that the living may know that the Most High rules the kingdoms of men and gives it to whom he will and sets over it the lowliest of men. So Daniel, what does this mean? Well, Daniel wishes it were otherwise, but he tells the king, this is you. God has established your kingdom and he's raised it up. And in you all of the earth find shelter. But God's going to take it away from you because you've dishonored him. And you're going to become like the beast of the field for a period of 7 years. You will wander the grass. Your hair will be dew with the morning. And at the end of 7 years, you will be restored. And we go on, okay? And we're going to get to the end. So we see 7 years this has happened. And how does it happen? Why does it happen? I don't understand people sometimes. He gets his interpretation from a man he trusts, obviously. And he goes out and he looks over his city and says, oh man, what a great person I am. Look at all that I have built. Whammo! So 7 years goes by. At the end of the 7 years, he says, at the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven, and my reason returned to me, and I blessed the Most High, and praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. Now, do you guys even understand what that means? His dominion is an everlasting dominion. That means he rules always without end. He's the boss forever. Okay? And his kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing. And he does according to his will among the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. And none can stay his hand or say to him, what have you done? Why was this happening? Why did this happen? Because there is no authority on earth except that which is established for God, by God, for his purposes. You think Saddam Hussein was an accident? This says otherwise. You think Adolf Hitler was an accident? This says otherwise. Now see, this right here should show you how small your brain is. Because I would have never put Hitler in charge of anything. But God saw fit to put Hitler in charge of Germany. And he allowed devastation to come upon his people Israel. To what end? I don't know the furthest reaches, but I do know this. If World War II had not happened, if the concentration camps had not happened, if the guilt of that had not seared the consciences of the world, Israel would not have become a nation years later. I believe that with all my heart. Nobody wanted Israel to be a nation. But after this happened, they voted Israel a nation. They gave back to her her land. Now, God does as God wills. You know, God almost never checks things out with me.
Almost never.
He's warned me a couple times. It's God's to do with as he wills. His will be accomplished. Who can frustrate the will of God? Now I'm going to go one more passage here regarding the authority. Let's flip over to the book of John. We're at John chapter 19. Now remember, we just talked about the fullness of the deity of God, the dwelling in Christ. Fully God, fully man. He suffered every temptation that we will ever suffer, that we have ever suffered and yet withstood them. And he gets arrested, betrayed by one of his intimate friends. He's arrested. He's taken before the religious leaders of the day, who had the word that showed he was coming, that showed what he would do, that showed where he, I mean, you look at the number of prophecies in the Old Testament that he fulfilled just by being born. I would put my bets on that one. And the religious leaders, who are threatened because his teaching calls them to account, how dare you challenge me? And Jesus spoke harshly to them. He called them to task more harshly than any other group of people anywhere. Why? Because they had the knowledge, they had the wisdom, and they were to share it with grace. They were to prepare the people for his coming, and they rejected him. So they turn him over to Pilate. Now this cracks me up. They bring him to Pilate, and they say, "We're bringing him to you. Well, what do you want me to do with him? We want you to execute him because we're not allowed." Think back a few chapters when they're trying to trap Jesus, and they bring the woman caught in adultery. They're going to stone her. Obviously, they could kill people. So why were they turning him over to the Gentiles? One, to fulfill prophecy. Two, they wanted to wash their hands. They didn't want the people that were believers of Jesus to come after them. The Romans did it. It's a Roman cross that he was hung upon. It was Pilate that sentenced him. Hate the Romans! You see, it served a twofold purpose. It eliminated a threat to their rule, and it furthered their political agenda of fomenting trouble with Rome. Okay? Think about that. These were no dummies, but they were ignorant. So they turned him over to Pilate. Pilate wants to set him free. "No, no, no, crucify him, crucify him. We want the murderer of Barabbas. Give him to us." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has made himself the Son of God." Which is funny because, we'll deal with that later. When Pilate heard the statement, he was even more afraid. He entered the headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you?" Think about that for a minute. The creator of heaven and earth standing before him. The one through whom everything is held together by his will is standing before him. And this guy has the shallowness of mind and the blindness of sight to say, "Don't you know I have authority over you?" That's irony. And Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." Where does Pilate's authority come from? Because see, I know what Pilate's thinking right here. Why was Pilate in Jerusalem? You know why Pilate was in Jerusalem? He was in Jerusalem because he was friends with the wrong people. Did you know that? He was friends with a general who tried to overthrow Caesar. And because of his complicity in the friendship, he was booted out from nice positions and put to that backwater town of Jerusalem in charge of those rebellious, fractious people, the Jews. So who is Pilate thinking Jesus is referring to?
Caesar.
The only authority you got came from Caesar. But who do we know that Jesus is referring to?
God.
All authority. Jesus knows the writings of Daniel. He's responsible for them. So he knows where the authority comes from. And so he says to Pilate, "This is the authority that is given you is only given you from above. You would have no authority here. If it weren't from my Father, who are you kidding?" You gotta wonder sometimes how Jesus dealt with the stupidity of us. I mean, you really do. The disciples were shocked when he got arrested. For weeks before, he'd been telling them, "I'm going up to Jerusalem to be arrested, and they're gonna kill me." "Oh, Peter, what's going on? They just came and got Jesus!" Now, I can say it like that because I've read backwards. I'd have been one of those guys. I'd have probably been the one running around in my skivvies. Okay? But Jesus reaffirms right here that the only authority that is in place comes from above. And Paul just said that all authority is his. Okay? So, why is it that all truth depends on Christ? One, he's the maker of it all. He's the only one that understands how it operates. He understands the principles that we screw up. He is God. He has the authority to do it howsoever he will. The laws of physics only apply to us, not to him. The natural laws we see in effect in our planet do not apply to him. But I don't know which of us can take a couple of fish and some loaves of bread and feed 5,000 plus. Well, we don't have anything small enough to give people even a little taste. But they ate and were filled and had leftovers. See, that those laws don't apply to him. But we're going to try and fit him into the laws that he created and that we misrepresent and misunderstand. I want to share one more passage with you. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Just going to flip over there real quick. You know, when I was a kid, I had a Formula One matchbox car. And when I played with that matchbox car, it flew. Because it made sense to me with the aerodynamic design and the wings that came out like that and the thing that came up on the back, that if you went fast enough, it would fly. It made sense. You know? I mean, it looks kind of like a stubby-winged airplane. And I was vehement in my disagreement with my brother that he insisted that that very shape is what kept it on the ground. The point being, it doesn't matter if it makes sense to you. It doesn't matter if it reconciles nicely and fits into the little niches of your brain. 1 Corinthians, Paul's writing to the Corinthians. Verse 18. Paul writes, "For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, and to us who are being saved it is the power of God." You see the dichotomy there? See, this is the problem. Those that are dying don't get the message of the gospel. They don't understand it. It doesn't make sense. As a matter of fact, we stink because of it. But to those that are living, it is proof of the power of God. Okay. For it is written, "I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart." Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand a sign, and Greeks seek wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews, and folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. See, I started off by telling you that in the Western Hemisphere, we're rooted in Greek thinking. And that's evident right here when Paul says that the Greeks seek wisdom. They want to know. They want to know. But see, God is foolishness. He chose to be foolish, to make weakness strength. How is it that You know, Paul can say, I glory all the more in my weakness, because then I am strong. It's the knothole of the cross. It's that whole convoluted thing that this world has twisted our thinking. And when, as God brings it straight, the world looks at us and thinks, you guys are weird. You're doing everything backwards. Why is it that the Christians should value other lives more than their own? But the world teaches us to value none but your own. See, the thinking is backwards. They become wise in their own eyes. Romans, it talks about the downward spiral of moral depravity, Romans chapter 1. And it talks about they became wise in their own eyes, and they ceased to worship God, who made himself apparent to them. And instead, they worshiped the creation rather than the Creator. We're still doing it today, people. We might not cut an idol out of wood, but we bow down before our TV and our latest have-to-have item. We bow down to the cultural ideology of advancement at any cost, a bigger house, a bigger car, new paint job, whatever. In Christ, we consider others better than ourselves. Matter of fact, in Christ, you really don't spend a lot of time considering yourself at all, because you die. The life you live is His, to do with as He wills. If He wants your life to stink according to the pattern of this world, then stink it up. You'll find much more happiness in stinking it up. If He wants your life to be a success according to the measure of this world, you better check yourself to see why, because it has nothing to do with you. Paul also tells us, what do you have that you did not receive from God? And if you received it from Him, why do you act like you didn't? Oh yeah, I worked hard for 40 years and look at all that I got. Really? You know, without God giving you the ability to work, you wouldn't have had any of that. Would that have changed who you are? No, it would just change what you got. We slide into the arrogant self-centeredness by thinking that we've accomplished something on our own. What can you accomplish without God? Keeping in mind, remember, it's by His very will that things are held together. Where was God when I was going through hardship and hurt? He was right there waiting for you to turn to Him, longing to hold you, to comfort you, to give you hope, to turn your mourning into laughter. See, we project our own frailties and our failures onto God because we can't deal with them in our own lives. Last week I talked about the difference between trials and consequences. We mess up and then we blame God. Oh, look what God did! Excuse me. You drank yourself insensible and wrecked your car and it's His fault. You mismanaged your money. You mistrusted Him with your money. You're a poor steward of everything He gave you. Your finances are a wreck, and it's His fault? Listen to me, you don't need a car. You understand that? You don't need a car, much less a specific car. What you need is the ability to get from point A to point B. Don't set your arrogance in determining what you think you need. We don't understand what we need. We learned a pretty abrupt lesson about that early on in our marriage. We were living here in Montana. It was the first time we lived here. And we got up in the morning and Christy put the last piece of bread in the toaster for the kids. That was it. We're done. God, we got nothing. We don't even have lunch. Okay, God, you're going to have to provide. Your word says that you are our provision. You've never seen a righteous man's children begging bread. God, you're going to have to provide. 11 o'clock. Open the door, and there's a teenager from our church. Looked like he just rolled out of bed. Hair sticking up. Hey, Mr. Van Noe. He's holding a flat of cup of noodles. Yeah, my mom's babysitting down the street, and we got the whole flat. We only needed about four of them, and we thought maybe you guys might like some cup of noodles. We went through about a week and a half of eating macaroni and cheese. And I gotta tell you, I'm not a big fan of macaroni and cheese anymore. And I pray, God, now there's a reference to the Old Testament in here. God, please. We got a case of tuna. And so I ate tuna. And I was reminded of the Israelites complaining in the desert. Meat, give us meat. I got tuna. See, we need to understand that God knows our needs. He knows what we need. And He has promised to meet our needs. Don't get so caught up in your wants and confusing them with needs. And then judging God because He doesn't give you according to your expectation. His plans for you are better than you for yourself. Okay? His plans are better. Because He knows how it works. Seek Him. What does that say? Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. All too often we spend too much time seeking those other things and hoping that the kingdom and the righteousness will fall in after. We walk into our faith this way, backwards. Okay? So, here before you today, I'm telling you, where are you captive? What thoughts have you been deceived by? What things have taken you away from the truth of Christ? What philosophies has the world lied to you about? What have you lied to yourself about? Bring it to the cross. Bring it to the grace that is symbolic of the cross. He will tell you what you need. He will tell you everything that you need. He gives it to you. He takes care of you. He takes care of you better oftentimes than our own parents took care of us. Actually better every time than our home parents took care of us, regardless of how good your parents were. He's got the authority. It's all His. He's got everything that He needs to know about you and your situation. I crack myself up sometimes telling God my problems. And I could just see Him sit there going, I know. Okay, let's stop talking about problem. Let's start talking about solution. Okay? Because in Him is all God. I don't know. I want the one to handle my problems that built all of this, holds it together with the power of His will. I want Him on my side pulling for me. I make a mess of it myself. You will make a mess of it yourself. Amen?